Debt mutual fund space has seen a lot of innovation and product launches over the last few months. So you have target maturity funds, you have floating rate funds, and these new mutual funds are investing in high quality debt papers. So they are investing in state development loans and government securities. And you already have 16 debt mutual fund categories to choose from. So to simplify all this complexity, today we are joined by Mrin Agarwal. She is a registered financial advisor and she will simplify the world of debt investment space for you.
There are multiple categories, 16 categories in debt mutual fund space. So just simplify this entire structure and which ones should a retail investor focus on?
Firstly, figure out what is their investment horizon, and based on their investment horizon, see what are the categories available. So if you really want to do investment for a short period of time, let's say up to periods of 1 or 2 years, you have liquid funds, you have ultra short duration fund, low duration fund, and arbitrage funds. And then you have categories which basically offer periods above 3 years. So you have short duration, medium duration, long duration, dynamic bond, PSU, and everything. To cut the long story short, I really think that if your investment is short term in nature, which is 0 to 3 months, go with liquid. Anything between 6 months to 3 years, just go with low duration or ultra short duration. And I think anything above 3 years, I would go just with short duration funds, because I find that the risk adjusted returns in the short duration funds are much better as compared to other categories.
Then how to identify red signals if something is going wrong? Then how do they figure out that, yeah, this is the time to exit from this fund? So avoid Franklin-like episode.
You know, I think while investing itself, you need to get the category right, because what I see is that normally people invest in a debt fund based on the last 1 year return. So, you know, we get a lot of queries on gilt funds, for example. But given the fact that we are looking at interest rates rising, certainly it's not a good idea to invest in gilt funds right now, right? So I think, you know, the first thing is to really get the category right based on your investment horizon. And I think the second thing is to say that if a particular fund is giving a very high return compared to the rest of the funds, then you need to question as to why it's happening. Of course, you need to do hygiene checks by looking at the credit quality of the fund and stuff like that. But I think, you know, the main thing is, you know, to question as to why a fund is giving higher return as compared to the rest of the category, look at the credit profile of the fund as well.
And now in last 1 year, we have seen a lot of innovation in this space, and Bharat Bond ETFs have been launched, and then you have more target maturity ETFs and mutual funds. So what is a target maturity fund? Just simplify it for viewers.
So essentially, it's a fund which is going to mature on a particular date, and it's open-ended. So you can enter and exit anytime, but the fund is going to mature on a specific date. And what happens is that the maturity of the fund keeps falling as time passes, basically. Now, why are there target maturity funds? Because I think they are really positioning themselves as being an alternate to fixed deposit, a more tax-efficient alternative to fixed deposits. Because if you look at the current expected returns from most of these, you're looking at, you know, maybe getting anywhere between 5.75 to 5.9% post-tax for a 5 to 6 year period, right? So compare that to FD, where you will get a 6%, but it's going to be fully taxable. So I think, you know, these funds work well for people who are looking at an alternative to a fixed deposit. But I feel that, you know, you should lock in into these only if you're looking at a fixed return. You know, if you're looking at a longer term investment into debt funds, then I don't believe that these funds work for you. And again, you should remember that all funds are not the same. There are some of them which are investing in corporate bonds, let's say PSU bonds and government bonds. There are some of them which are investing only in state government bonds, right? And then there are some of them which are saying, no, we'll do only central government bonds. So you see, each of these bonds comes with a different risk profile. And I still think that a short-term debt fund, you know, which has got a combination of corporate bonds, state government bonds, central government bonds, and it's actively managed in terms of the weightages and allocations, would any day work better than taking a fund which is concentrated on one side of the bond story.
And what are floater funds? We have seen a lot of floater funds also being launched in last few months. So what are those?
So floater funds are those which invest at least 65% in floating rate bonds, and the rest of it is going to be in derivatives like interest rate swaps. So essentially the whole idea is that if interest rates were to go up, then these funds will automatically reprice themselves because they're holding floating rate bonds. So that is what is floater funds. I think, you know, there are not too many floating rate bonds available in the first place. And I think one really needs to wait out to see how the strategy really works out.
A simple retail investor, how should they choose a debt fund among all? How, on what parameters should they go for?
So very clearly, it needs to be based on investment horizon, right? So for how long can you hold the investment? That's point number one. Certainly, you should not be looking at what the last 1 year return is. And the category needs to be chosen based on the last 1 year investment. Then you need to look at the yield to maturity and the modified duration as well. And of course, you need to look at the credit quality of the fund in order to start investing. I think one of the hygiene checks that can in any case be done is to see in the past, in long-term periods, has the fund been able to give consistent rolling returns? Unfortunately, all of this is quite difficult for most people to figure out. You know, we're talking about rolling returns, duration. Even if you have the duration data, you know, how does a retail investor figure out whether this is the right duration or not? So, you know, that is why I always believe that if you have a holding period of above 3 years, just go with a short duration debt fund. And periods less than 3 years, as I mentioned, look at the ultra short term bond funds, look at liquid funds.